Well, it's time for a new build. So we've got finally cleared the title, and I pulled it out of the garage. I still haven't taken any of the dust off, and I'm gonna have to clean out this tank. There's a couple of carburetors laying in there, that's a bonus, but it needs a lot. See, this is leaning down and no pad on here. And the good thing about this bike is it's only got 9,700 miles on it, and it's an R5, not an RD, R5 350, but basically it's an RD 350, and it's pretty complete other than, you know, air cleaner, a seat, guess the blinker over here. Some of these parts I might have just thrown in a box somewhere too. But I'm gonna be able to get these exhausts looking great. And I really don't think that they're rusted through in the bottom. Let's take a look. No, not really. Just dirty. Oh, look at that nice motor. Yeah, that's for that motor. It's gonna need to almost come out. Probably will pull it out. But like everyone I'm doing now, I'm gonna run the motor and test drive it more than once, because on my VF500C, and I know that all those guys in Shingletown want to know, and you know, they keep calling me and giving me videos, and you know, of different VF500s and street trackers and whatever I'm building, they always give me all kinds of input, which I really enjoy. But this one has a dead hole. I didn't check it out. So I had another engine laying around, and it's obviously hasn't been detailed, but I put it in to the frame a few days ago, and it fired up, it sounded smooth, and I started pulling plugs, you know, pulling plug wires one at a time to see if each cylinder, you know, drops the RPM down. And this one had a dead hole too in the back. So obviously the rear cylinders take more abuse. Although it's water cooled, I wouldn't think that'd be an issue. But, you know, or it's just a coincidence that both motors had bad holes in the back. And so when I did a leak down test on this one, I got a bad intake valve. And then it basically, I think I screwed up, and it's a bad exhaust valve, but they're not bad. I just took them off. Guess this is going to be an update on the VF500C Cafe Racer. But I just lapped the valves and cleaned all of them up here. And I did the test where you fill the intake runner with fuel and see if it leaks out. And boy, the one hole that was bad, it was just running out of. And I got it down now to where a couple of these valves actually have a little, you can, if you sit there for an hour, you'll see a little discoloration, a little bit of wetness around, like a ring around the outer edge of the valve. And I'm pretty sure I did a lot of dirt bikes, a lot of CRF 450s, and I got it, you grind them down a little bit, and you know, it'll seal, it'll run, And I mean, I just go down to the show, I go down to bike night or wherever. I'm not putting any miles on it, so. And God knows what it would cost to completely do the head. And if you're going to do that, you might as well do the other head. And if you're going to do that, you might as well just re-ring it. And if you're going to do that, well, let's just rebuild the whole thing and try and find all those parts. So anyway, that's an update on the VF500C for all those guys down in Shingletown that just have to know and keep contacting me all the time wanting to know and also wanting to buy these bikes. I don't know why, but they want to buy them. I think it's more fun to build one. So anyway, this is the beginning of the the R5 350 1972 Resto. Okay, it's time to see. Well, I've already seen if it runs and shifts. And it actually runs pretty good. It shifts perfect. The clutch is really hard. I think it's the cable is rusted so much that it's just difficult to pull it in. But if I turn on the ignition switch here, right here, this is the ignition switch. Let me put this down. Okay, ignition on, gas on. Turn off the ignition switch there. One of the baffles fell out right as I pulled into the driveway. Here's what it looks like with it in. The damn thing just blew out. And, I found the screw. There's the screw. So I've got the screw and the baffle now. But anyhow, it runs, it shifts, it's ready. Ready for the teardown and the restoration. I've got it pretty well stripped down and I've got it close to coming out. But as you can see, it's just years and years and years and years and years of dirt and grime and all that. I did manage to get the chain to look pretty decent. A little 525 chain. I'll reuse that chain. I only go down to bike night. I put new chains and sprockets on, but this one doesn't look bad. It's probably original, 9,000 miles. Teeth are a little long, I guess. I don't know. That'll work. I may just put another one on later. But what a interesting way to get this out. It's got a little cutout here to get that through. Got it jacked up, and of course it's got to be a one-man project for me, so once I get that out, it'll be forks, rear wheel, and swing arm, and I'll do the same thing that I did. Oh, there's the helper, and you just used a little low pressure washer. I could get a real high-powered one, but I don't use it that much. And really, probably too much pressure on motorcycle parts are not good. But this was total gunk. And it's clean. They're clean. And a little further cleaning. And I'll be ready for the paint booth. These are gonna take some real work. They were pressure washed, but You'll be amazed how these will come out. You think there's a few years of buildup and that two strokes might be a little dirtier, grimier than a four stroke? I think so. So that's where it's at now. Next is to get the front forks off, get all these paintable pieces out, cleaned, and I might just paint first. I'm not gonna go with the black color scheme that they had on the tank. This is Mandarin Orange Candy. I'm going back to that, and I think it'll be beautiful. Just candy, Mandarin Orange. And if somebody wanted to, they could just scuff the clear, do the black, and then put another coat of clear on it is all. Everything has been clean, then cleaned again, and then cleaned with Grow Super Clean, ready for paint. First coat is on. And I probably could just do the first coat. I mean, it's pretty nice. But boy, is there a lot on this motorcycle. Other stuff to paint. This fork or foot peg deal, and then a support and bracket, and then the battery tray, center stand, and swing arm. Out of the paint shop. Got all kinds of pieces here. And you know damn well, there's a piece or two that I didn't paint. I know, somewhere I'll find it. But I've used this in the past. I know a lot of people want a powder coat. And I would powder coat, but you know what? I started this yesterday, and I have it on my bench today. Of course, I've got the paint booth, but still, you know, you take all this into a powder coater, not only will it be expensive, but I'll be waiting a week or two or three. So I've been using this Summit Chassis Shield in the semi-gloss. And, you know, it really, really is a cool product, and it'll go right over bare metal. And I didn't have to really prep too much. Now, when I do a custom frame with a custom color, you know, it's a base coat, clear coat. And that in itself is a little more work, but it's very nice. But this is a classic black frame, and you know, it comes out very shiny, very beautiful, and I've done a number of frames in this Summit Chassis Shield. We've got the first coat of primer. Nice big dent right there. Let's see how it blocks out. I'm sure there's a little wave here or there. We get all that when we do the final sanding, but it looks straight. I don't see any lines. I kind of see a line from the old stripe, and I'm not going to go back to those stripes because I just think it's ugly. I know it's not 100% original, but the color will be original. I'm just not going to put the black stripes on it. It's just going to be nice and clean Mandarin, candy Mandarin orange. I found something that seems to work pretty damn good. I just got a little pail of vinegar. I soaked the petcock in it and these bolts. Now, they didn't come out looking like this. They came out all discolored, kind of a blackish look to them from the acid. Then I took them to the parts washer and washed most of it off, and then I took a wire wheel, and I can't believe I do a lot of wire wheel on bolts, but my God, this thing, the acid, this is a new bolt, but it's not, this thing, and the, you know, I wire wheeled as everywhere I could get in there, and look what it did to the brass. Of course, you know, wire wheel with brass works great, but things don't come out this shiny without the acid. I could do the parts washer and then do a wire wheel, but it just seems like something makes it really shine. So it's just a little something I played with. We're ready to spray. It's been all wet sanded, blocked out, and ready to go. First coat of base, and you can see that it's real thin. And we'll see what we can do on the second coat. This is with two coats of the candy mid coat, and it's really the color that I'm trying to achieve. So I'm only going to go with two. You can go three, four, changes the color. I don't know if it's really necessarily going to get darker, but it went from a red to a tangerine. And this is the color that I'm supposed to be putting on the bike, so there it is.
Okay, we're
done with the clear coat. And we're tangerine. Tangerine dreams and whatever, strawberry smiles. Yeah, it's all good and shiny. So this is the end of the first run, or the first part of the 1972 R5 Yamaha 350. So I'm going to just pick up on part two, where I'll start to put everything together and show you the battle I'm having with the fork tubes. Till then, see you later.